We got a bit of bad news this month from the Mauna Loa Observatory in Hawaii, which is where they monitor atmospheric carbon dioxide concentrations. Apparently, we've just tipped over 420 parts per million for the first time in human history. Now, as you probably know, that increase in CO2 concentration is warming our atmosphere and playing a major role in the catastrophic changes we're witnessing in our climate. A major driver of CO2 emissions is, of course, the use of fossil fuels around the world. So one of the burning questions of our time, so to speak, is just how quickly we can get ourselves off those carbon-heavy fuels and onto more sustainable forms of energy generation that don't release carbon dioxide at the point of use. At an industry conference called All Energy, held at the Glasgow SEC in May, the chairman of Shell UK, David Bunch, delivered a speech insisting that natural gas is an indispensable transition fuel and the only way to effectively wean ourselves off coal. But a comprehensive study released around the same time by energy industry analysts Transition Zero paints a very different picture. It suggests a global system in which countries would actually save money by completely bypassing natural gas and jumping straight from coal to renewable technologies like solar, wind and battery energy storage. So how do they work that out then? Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. So I guess you're wondering who Transition Zero are and why they know better than the chairman of one of the largest fossil fuel producers in the world. Well, they're a not-for-profit organisation established in 2020 from a core team of experts, all of whom previously worked at the highly respected independent financial think tank Carbon Tracker. Their mission is to bring a bit of clarity to the complexity of making like-for-like comparisons between different utility-scale fuel sources so that the costs involved in moving from one source to another in different countries around the world can be more accurately assessed. Believe it or not, no such tool previously existed for short-run energy analytics in the industry, which meant that when it came to assessing the climate impacts of fuel switching, policymakers and investors were effectively flailing around in the dark. This most recent report is called Fuel Switching 2.0 and features an index that Transition Zero called Coal to Clean Carbon Price Index, or C3PI, which should of course not be confused with a whinging gold android from Star Wars.
This is madness!
Applying a carbon price to a fuel source already occurs through general trading conditions or as a result of mechanisms like the carbon tax or the EU emissions trading scheme. C3PI is an open data project that's been specifically designed to assess the carbon price in dollars per tonne of carbon dioxide needed to cause a switch from coal to gas compared to the carbon price needed to cause a switch directly from coal to new onshore wind or solar PV plus battery storage. All the workings and methods that Transition Zero use are set out in a separate report, which uses information from a database of coal plants developed by another analytics organisation called Global Energy Monitor. For existing coal and fossil gas plants, the analysis uses a metric known as short-run marginal cost, or SRMC. It includes things like the cost of the fuel itself, plus the variable operations and maintenance costs, and any existing carbon costs associated with the plant. For new build natural gas plants, the levelized cost of electricity, or LCOE, is used. That's a much more familiar metric to most of us, representing the average total cost of building and operating a power plant over its assumed lifetime. Using those definitions, you get a set of equations for working out the numbers. So if you're planning to swap from existing coal to existing gas, then you take the short-run marginal cost, or SRMC, of gas minus the SRMC of coal and divide that by the difference in carbon emissions intensity, measured in tonnes of carbon dioxide per megawatt hour, between the two fuel types. And if you want to swap from existing coal to a brand new gas-powered facility, then you take the levelized cost of electricity, or LCOE, of the new gas plant minus the SRMC of coal, divided by the difference in emissions intensities. LCOE analysis only takes into account power generation, though. It doesn't factor in any other added value services to the grid, like frequency regulation and dispatchability. So to provide a more level playing field, the cost of battery energy storage has to be added to the cost of renewables before any comparisons can be made with existing fossil fuels. So to get a carbon price that justifies a switch from existing coal directly to renewables, you take the LCOE of renewables plus storage minus the cost of existing coal, and simply divide that by the carbon emissions intensity of coal, because of course there are no carbon emissions from the operation of renewables. You get the idea? Now, those studious folks at Transition Zero have crunched all the numbers for 25 different countries using data taken from the International Energy Agency's World Energy Outlook reports, going right back to 2010. Back then, switching from coal to gas looked like an obvious choice at a required carbon price of only about $20 per tonne of carbon dioxide, compared to more than $500 per tonne for a switch to renewables. But we all know what's happened to the price of wind and solar in the last decade, don't we? And of course, that's directly reflected in this chart. As the years roll on, the two lines converge until we reach a crossover point this year as gas prices go completely crazy. The most recent data points from April 2022 show a required carbon price of $488 per tonne to switch from coal to gas and minus $44 per tonne to switch from coal to clean renewables. The 2022 average carbon price so far is $235 for coal to gas and minus $62 for coal to clean renewables, representing an extraordinary decline of 99% since 2010. That's a global average, of course, which is useful as a general guide to global policy, but doesn't show the variation from country to country. So the team drilled down into a second layer of granularity to produce this historical chart showing the carbon price to switch from coal to clean renewables in the top 10 countries over the same period. In Europe, the cost of switching is now negative as a result of rising carbon prices from policy reforms to the emissions trading scheme, plus decades of policy support for renewable energy, and of course Russia's invasion of Ukraine, which has caused a big spike in the price of coal. China and the US are world leaders in renewable energy, but they're both still churning out coal at relatively low domestic prices. So at least at the moment, that partially offsets the cost advantages of switching to renewables. Fuel switch costs in Southeast Asia are influenced by the subsidisation of coal and gas, as well as the fact that renewable energy is still quite a nascent industry compared to other countries. Japan has one of the highest coal to clean fuel switch prices as a result of land use constraints and some quite discriminatory regulations. But despite those obstacles, there has been a clear deflationary trend in every country, which, as the Transition Zero team point out, must surely cast some doubt on the wisdom of the 615 gigawatts of gas and 442 gigawatts of coal currently under construction around the world. It's not difficult to project forward using this data analysis to see that those massive investments are very likely to become stranded assets well before the end of their operational lifetime. And that risk means that fossil fuel investment cycles are likely to continue to shorten as producers remain under pressure from investors and policymakers to avoid a catastrophically loss-making future. Trade bans from places like Indonesia and the EU show how trade is increasingly being used to support energy security and enforce environmental goals. All those volatile variables in the fossil fuel markets will probably keep heaping pressure on consumers, businesses, and governmental balance sheets for the foreseeable future. The research team points out that while zero carbon technologies are not immune to fluctuations in the supply chain, they're much less likely to suffer from the same volatility as fossil fuels because once they're up and running, they're just using the wind and sun to produce power. That means they have near zero marginal costs, which in turn must surely mean that renewables will need to play a crucial role in reducing the impact of the energy crisis. So how do we get there? Well, according to Transition Zero, the most obvious first step would be to get rid of existing subsidies in coal, gas, and end-user electricity prices. Those distortions are delaying the implementation of renewables. If you and I had to pay the real cost of powering our homes using fossil fuels, things would change very quickly indeed. There's also a need for what's known as cash-to-close policies. Based on the Transition Zero analysis, nearly 3,000 coal plants need to be replaced between now and 2030, and there'll need to be some state assistance to make sure this happens. And policy support for renewables needs to be ring-fenced so that zero carbon investors don't have to suffer the vagaries of different governments over successive election cycles on top of the existing technological and market risks they already have to bear. Last but not least is the thorny issue of permitting. There is clearly political will to increase renewables capacity around the world, but the Transition Zero team argue that permitting is a major bottleneck, slowing deployment and increasing the cost of zero carbon sources of electricity generation. According to Wind Europe, overly complex rules, grindingly slow procedures and generally inadequate staffing levels mean that the permitting lead time for onshore wind deployment can take up to 10 years. That is bonkers, and it needs to change very quickly. Now, as usual in my little 12-minute video segments, I've only been able to give you a snapshot of the full analysis. Transition Zero say that as a result of the crazy market volatility we're all experiencing right now, they'll be updating the CP3I index every week for the United States and Europe, and once a month for all the other countries. And of course, I'll leave links in the description section below to that report, plus all the other supporting documentation that Transition Zero referenced. And of course, if you've got your own views on how the transition to sustainable energy should take place, then why not jump down to the comments section below and leave your thoughts there. That's it for this week though. Thanks as always to our amazing Patreon supporters who help me maintain the channel's independence and keep advertising out of these videos. And a special thank you to the folks whose names are scrolling at the side of the screen right now, all of whom reached a Patreon support anniversary landmark in May. If you feel like you could support the channel for the price of a coffee each month and keep me making these videos every Sunday, then you can find out how to do that by visiting patreon.com/justhaveathink. And of course, you can always show your support completely for free by clicking the subscribe button and hitting the notification bell so you don't miss a video. It's just a simple click if you're on a PC, tablet or smartphone, which you can do down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week and remember to just have a think. See you next week.